I think we're breaking new ground in this marketing. I don't remember, of all the many dental meetings I've been to, I don't remember anybody ever lecturing on this aspect of marketing, this subconscious aspect of marketing. But this is the marketing that really works, as opposed to the marketing that people theorize will work. And this is what we're going to teach you today. To understand the interplay of logic and emotion in a patient's decision to choose a dentist, to learn how to use your website to create the most effective first impression of your practice, and to learn how to generate more phone calls from your practice. We're going to open your eyes to this new world because a lot of marketing is based on logic. A lot of what you see out there, a lot of the dental marketing assumes that it's logical. It's not. So, Einstein was a great fan of intuition over logic, and that's how he made his great discoveries. The problem with your marketing is that you think it's all about logic. It's partly about logic, but it's not even primarily about logic. Whether they like you or not is an emotional thing, and until you understand that, you're not going to be as successful as you could be.
Yeah, and I'd like to introduce Dave Hall here. He told you a little bit about himself, but not only is he my father, but he's also been practicing cosmetic dentistry for 22 years in his career. Before he founded Infinity Dental Web, he's the president of the company, and he also has had a lifelong fascination with marketing. Also, another fact about him is this is his 30th year as a member of the AECD. And so I would say, in some ways, it is a lifelong membership.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, and your quote?
I've been practicing brand marketing for my whole career, and I will teach you about this. A brand is not a product or a service. It is a thought in the mind of the consumer and a feeling in their heart. You got into dentistry because of a passion and heart. And we're going to tell you how you can translate that into marketing. So we'll start with a taste test for you today. Okay? This is a virtual taste test. Imagine I'm going to give you two glasses of fizzy, cool cola. There's no markings on the glass, but one is Pepsi and one is Coca-Cola. Which one tastes better? Majority of people will tell you that Pepsi tastes better. And this was, of course, the famous Pepsi challenge. But in a blind taste test, I see your head nodding right there. And we're going to explain why Coca-Cola does taste better to some people. And that is because if I were to do the exact same test, but this time give you the same temperature, the same fizzy cola in a branded bottle, and hand them to you and say, here's Pepsi and here's Coca-Cola, which one's going to taste better? For most people, it's going to be Coca-Cola. And why is that? It's the brand. It's the response. And when you actually measure the neurological response, it is different, even though you're tasting the exact same beverage. Before, you feel pleasure centers activating in your mind when you try the Pepsi. And then when you know what the brand is, we can measure and recognize that the same pleasure centers, meaning that it actually does taste better. It's not just that you're convincing yourself it tastes better, it actually does taste better. And that's going to be the crux of what we're going to share with you today. And how did that brand become so powerful? I'll tell you, it's over a century of marketing around one concept, which is happiness.
Hey, Coca-Cola?
You're in luck. It's happy hour. So, you want a free Coca-Cola, but you have to drink it here. No one can
So that's like the opposite of a blind taste test, obviously. I think she would probably say that Coca-Cola tastes better.
So, do you tell them manipulating your emotions there in that Coke commercial? They certainly do. We're going to teach you how to do that too. This is a client of ours in Cleveland, very successful practice, gets 30 to 50 new patients a month from his website. Okay, he wanted to get a little more aggressive in his marketing. He wanted to put up a little box asking people for an email address. I said, Brad, I don't know that that's a good idea, but he was really wanting to try it. I said, okay, let's do this. Let's use you as a research subject. We'll put this up, we'll take it down in alternate months. We'll see if it affects your calls. He said, okay, let's do it. So we did this. We put it up, you can see the brown. I might have to do without, I can't see where my pointer's. That's not going to be very good. Okay, you can see the brown one. That's where the box was on the website. This is the time spent on the site. This is a measure of visits over 30 seconds or visits over 5 minutes, because we wanted to see if people found this annoying, is one question. And apparently they didn't. While there's a slight decrease in the length of visit, it's not statistically significant. But when you go to the calls, there's a dramatic decrease in the calls. Why? Just a simple request for an email address. So we're going to teach you a little later why. You'll understand this. But you need to know this stuff, because when you start getting eager, you're violating some principles of what we call neuromarketing. So Michael, what is neuromarketing?
Well, generally it's the research of the brain, how the brain works, and how to use that in marketing, the learning out of the research.
Okay, I meant to introduce Michael. Michael Andre is with our company, and we're using some excerpts of interviews. He's our chief marketing strategist. He has some global experience in marketing major brands, just like Brian does. And he did some award-winning research on newer marketing. This is the field that we're talking to you about. Marketing to the subconscious, understanding the brain function, and understanding how you can affect that. When these principles of neuromarketing were discovered, there was a great public debate. I remember reading this book, The Hidden Persuaders, when I was in high school. And the basic thesis of this is, this has got to be regulated. This is too much power. These marketers are going to manipulate us out of whatever they want to do. But we've since matured and realized that these principles are available for everybody. So it's a free marketplace. We're free to manipulate each other as we know how. But I wanted to also put this neuromarketing into the context, into the broader context of the current status of internet marketing. And it's changing rapidly, and I just wanted to bring you up to speed with where things are going. It used to be that search engine optimization was the big thing, and when our company started, that was our big emphasis. But it's not so much anymore. Google has taken away the tricks that used to work to get you optimized. They don't work anymore. And so it's becoming less important to be number one. It's a quality site that impresses Google now. Google is sitting in their boardrooms day after day trying to figure out, how do we discover which are the really good websites to list first in our rankings? And so they've tried to cut out all these tricks. They're trying to get at that, and they're getting pretty good at it. Just as an example, this is one of our clients in the New Orleans area. He had a design that wasn't too bad, but all we did was improve the design of the website. His Google rankings went up, and his traffic went up by about 50% from those improved rankings, just from the redesign. In other words, Google figured out that this was a better website. Okay? Prospective patients will look further. Again, it used to be a big deal to be number one. People look past that now. They're going to look at four or five websites when they're looking for a cosmetic dentist. The one that impresses them the most is the one where they'll call and make an appointment. This is an example of a client in Houston. His website was ranked on the first page of Google, reasonably high. not feeling like he was getting the number of calls that he should get. We put up a new design, same ranking, same traffic, calls had almost doubled after the redesign. This was the impact that that had on it, without any increase in ranking. And the interesting thing is, his referrals were up. So people are not just relying on simple referrals anymore. You get a referral from your friend, you go check out the website. And then you see, you know, maybe I agree with this referral, maybe I don't. This is happening. This is not our website, but this is a client we're working on creating a website for him. And he has realized this trend that patients for a periodontist are self-referring. You refer somebody to a periodontist, the patient says, maybe I like that periodontist, maybe I don't. I don't know, let me look at his website. So reviews are growing in importance. This is a trend that's been going on for several years. Now, we have data at Infinity Dental Web. We're pretty good at this research. You'll see a lot of data about reviews, the impact of reviews on dental patients. You'll see, for example, an 80% number, the number of patients that check reviews. This comes from generic studies where they're just asking consumers in general, do you use online reviews? About 80% do. Our data comes from specific patients looking for a dentist on the internet, and we are constantly monitoring this. And when we did this in 2014, 41% of new patients would check the reviews after checking the website before making an appointment. In 2015, it was up to 57%. Last year, it was up to 61%. You can see the trend. So these are changes. You can't, to stay on top of internet marketing, you've got to stay up with all this. And then the mobile search, of course, is growing. Amazon Echo, you just ask. And this could potentially dramatically affect the results of search. The right is a screenshot from my iPhone. I asked Siri, find me a dentist. Okay. So let's get now then into the neuromarketing, the subconscious marketing. We wanted to introduce you to some of the great minds in marketing that have been pioneers in this area.
Well, thank you. Now, we're going to introduce a couple people that have been really influential in brand marketing, in marketing research, marketing science, neuromarketing. And these are some sources you can look to as well for some of the information to go deeper with it if you'd like. The first is Louis Cheskin. Louis Cheskin was probably the first well-known marketing scientist, and he was brought in by agencies and by brands in the 1950s, 1960s. He actually was a great deal of the importance behind development of icons in advertising like the Marlboro Man and the Gerber Baby. He also was famous for advising Fleischmann Margarine. He says, "Why is your margarine white? It should be yellow. And it should be in a foil wrapper, just like butter." And that's true still today. You know, margarine in general is yellow. And that resulted in a huge, you know, uplift in sales. He was famous for putting the consumer at the center of the research. Rather than putting some psychologist at the center of the research, he said, let's talk to consumers, but before we just take at face value what they're saying, let's observe what they do. And the science has gotten so much more advanced. If Louis Cheskin pioneered neuromarketing, Robert Cialdini really exploded the field. He wrote a groundbreaking book in 1984 called Influence, The Psychology of Persuasion. And in this, he actually identified, based on research, based on functional magnetic resonance imaging, that you could see in the mind, like that Coca-Cola example, you could actually see in the mind how people's thoughts, emotions were being stimulated by a particular stimulus. And this was a field that he identified, and marketers ate this up, you know. And a lot of brands, like the brands that I've worked on, have been researching and using these principles for decades. He is also known on Fortune's 75 Smartest Book lists. He's got a place on the bookshelf there as well for this book, and I recommend that you check it out.
And then we go to Douglas Van Praet. I read this book 3 times. Great insights into subconscious marketing. Okay, we're going to show you some of his work. He's the guy that did this award-winning Super Bowl commercial. I want you to watch this and think, okay, how much is he using logic? How much is he trying to manipulate your emotions? It's pretty obvious. But try to analyze what he's doing to your emotions as we watch this Volkswagen commercial. How much information did you get there about the Passat? Practically nothing. It was a remote control start. But what did it do to your emotions? So this is masterful. He's taking this child figure, putting him in a Darth Vader costume, kind of, you know, mixing innocence and evil, you know, and making it cute. And, you know, we've got, he won our sympathies, didn't he? And we just think this is really cool. But anyway, again, we're going to teach you how to use these principles. And then this is really departing a little bit from the neuromarketing. But for dental marketing, my favorite expert is Suzanne Boswell. I think she may be retired now. The reason I liked her is all the other dental marketers that I would hear lecture would base their material on anecdotes, theory. She would actually go out and do focus groups and study and surveys and find out what was really going on. We're going to use some of the things that she discovered about dental marketing and then put that subconscious marketing twist of the 21st century onto it. So before joining Infinity Dental Web, I worked on some brands as a marketer that you might recognize from the store. Pillsbury, Nature Valley, Fiber One, Maytag, and Dial. What I've learned from running some of these brands is that there is a profound connection between fiber bars, dishwashers, and dentistry. And that's that they're all for humans. And as such, they rely on a profound emotional connection with the consumer, with the patient. And cosmetic dentists, you're all a step ahead on this because I know you don't think of yourselves as treating cavities, you think yourselves as treating smiles, right? And what is a smile? It's a response to an emotion, usually joy, and it's usually shared with somebody else. And what else is a response to an emotion? I shared this earlier, a brand is a response to an emotion. A brand is not your staff. It's not your experience. It's not your sign, your logo. It's not even how friendly you are. Your brand is what happens in the mind, in the heart of the consumer, the patient, when they interact with you. That is the definition of a brand. And understanding that is paramount. And we're going to talk to you about how a brand can be used to influence or persuade other people. So what we're going to do is we're going to actually do a manipulation exercise, and I want you guys all to have the experience of using one of the things right here in this lecture. And so what we're going to do is we're actually going to, this is not going to take, it's not going to be painful, I promise. But I want you to first turn to a neighbor, just to, you know, as a pair, right? Turn to somebody that's near you. Perfect. Okay. Now the person on the left, okay, the person on the left, raise your hand, person on the left or in the front or however. Okay. How are you guys feeling? Feeling pretty good? Did you, you know, it's the afternoon. Did you guys lose a lot of money at roulette yesterday? All right, think about how you're feeling. Okay, now the person on the right,
right? Now, first of all, I guess, person on the left, look at your neighbor. Person on the right, give that neighbor the biggest, friendliest smile that you can. Show off all of that work that you had done, right? Show it all off, okay? Now, all right, that's good, that's enough. Before you start analyzing their work, you know. All right, next thing, person on the left. Did you smile? Yeah? You smiled, okay. What happened here is you've been manipulated, congratulations, but in a very positive way, right? You may be feeling a little bit different than you were before. And this is an aspect, this is a stimulus that we're gonna talk about as well as four others. This one's called reciprocal altruism. And that means when someone gives you something, you typically give something back to them. You just feel that, it's a social norm, okay? We're gonna go through five of these. These are based off of, you know, we studied Cialdini, and he came up with some of these, but we at Infinity Dental Web have identified these five psychological stimuli. And so what these are things that over time they provoke a response, an emotional or a mental response from people, okay? So one of the most powerful is the first one, and that's the social proof stimulus. And what this means is we would kind of rather let everyone else do the deciding for us. Right? When it comes down to it, making decisions is hard, and we just kind of rather just follow the crowd. So you think about this as the bandwagon effect, trends, fads, or a herd mentality, okay? And marketers often use this when they advertise the number one best-selling mid-sized sedan, or America's most trusted laundry detergent, right? Or 50 million moms can't be wrong. That's the social proof mechanism for marketing. I worked on a brand called Cascadian Farm Organic, and we sold granola cereal. And we really wanted to become a mainstream brand, not just a niche granola brand. And so we really wanted to use social proof. But the problem is there's two things standing in the way of our brand becoming a social proof, you know, trend brand. And that is granola and organic, right? Those two words don't necessarily inspire mob mentality that we were looking for. And so what we did was we actually did a little research and we found that, hey, wouldn't you know, Cascadian Farm Organic Cereal was the number one best-selling granola. And so we said, America's favorite granola cereal brand. And that social proof then created this opportunity for us to become a mainstream accepted brand. And you'll notice as well, we actually knew that our core audience, you know, that was with us at the beginning, the, you know, the crunchy granola Birkenstocks crowd, right? We wanted to do a little homage to them, and so we put this little line up here. It says, thank you for making us America's favorite granola cereal brand. And that was to not be too full of ourselves. It was part of the brand identity, was to be a little bit humble. But you can still be humble and say, you're America's favorite. All right, to keep up with some of these trends, let me tell you about Harry Winston, right? This famous Fifth Avenue jewelry shop. Harry Winston had an interesting dilemma about 50 years ago. All right, one of their pearl suppliers in Tahiti had shipped a batch of pearls that were dusky, dark gray. All right, and they got these pearls, and you know they weren't any less rare. They were just felt like they were maybe less desirable, right? Black pearls, and so they weren't sure exactly what to do with them. And Harry Winston had this fabulous idea. He's like, well, no one's really seen these before. What's the value? Well, the value is whatever he thinks it is, and whatever he tells people it is. One of the most important aspects of social proof is price. If something is expensive, it is better. We all know that, we all believe that, we'll convince ourselves of that. So what did Harry Winston do? He put this black pearl in the window here on Fifth Avenue. He put diamonds and rubies all around it, and then he put this just outrageous price tag on it. And it was so outrageous that there was news written about it saying this is an insane amount of money to pay for something that doesn't look as beautiful as a classic white pearl. Only kings or celebrities could really afford to pay this much, and guess what? That's who bought it. Were the celebrities and the A-listers, and it became so ingrained that the black pearl was so valuable that still exists today. There's still a belief that black pearls are more valuable than classic white pearls, but it's just because, not because they're more rare, but just because of Harry Winston's bold move in the 1960s. And we're gonna tell you a little bit about that as well, right? So, one thing about price is, when you buy something, you spend a lot of money on something, you actually convince yourself that it was a good purchase after you made that purchase, right? You guys do that? Something doesn't, you know, you spend a fortune on something, it doesn't work. Guess who gets the blame? Me. You know, I must not have been using it right, you know. But you don't assign blame to the brand. I saw a gentleman in London last week, and he had a Maserati in front of his, you know, in front of his office, and it had broken down. And I just kept thinking, like, why in the world would you buy a Maserati when you could get a car that would be so much more reliable? But he's convinced himself, obviously, that it was a worthwhile decision to make, okay? So the second psychological stimulus that I want to talk about, we already talked about a little bit, and that's reciprocal altruism. Right, and that's what happens is when you get a gift, you feel a sense of debt, and you want to repay that debt. And we did that. We gave each other smiles, right? That's free. That's positive. But there's another manipulation exercise that I'd like you to try, and that is in about 7 months, you're probably putting together, you know, a holiday card list. And what I want you to do is I want you to go to, I want you to pick five random people, right? You don't know, they don't know you, go to whitepages.com or something, right? And look up their name, look up their address, send out five holiday cards to five people, okay? And then wait 12 months. And guess what? The odds are one of those people is going to write you back. And they're going to have no idea why they're doing it other than that you sent them a card. They don't know you, but they feel a sense of debt. And this has been done, this research, this study has been done before, and they find about 20% people respond. It's because of that gift that's been given to you, right? This is something that businesses take advantage of as well. And I want to share this. This is a review from an auto mechanic in my hometown. And you know what happened here is James C. from Everett, Washington, went to Tempe Auto Repair, got some recommendations, and guess what? They didn't do anything really for him. They didn't solve the problem. They didn't do the work. They referred him to somebody else. And he presumably had to still spend money, you know, to get his problem fixed. But they did something for him. They changed his oil, and they said, no charge. And what happened was, you know, how much did the auto mechanic probably spend? Maybe $50 or more on time and the oil. They could have probably charged $25 at least for the oil change and called it a day. But what they did was they got something far more valuable, and that is a five-star review on Yelp, way more valuable than $25. And that, paired with the other 21 five-star reviews on the site, is a very powerful response to either social proof, which we already discussed, or reciprocal altruism, right? And it got my attention as well. And the thing is, the review, the five-star review gets your attention, but then when you read the specifics about how this person is honest and they didn't charge for the work, that is what gets your attention. That's what makes the sale, okay? Now, another manipulation exercise that unfortunately you guys can't try unless you serve tables has maybe been tried on you, all right? This is very fascinating. Researchers have found that if a waiter or a server leaves a mint with you at the end of your check, you're likely to leave a tip that's 3% higher than you would have otherwise. All right, now if that same waiter were to bring two mints and say, here's an extra mint for you. Nice folks. Have a nice day. Guess what? That tip goes up to 14% higher. Now, here's the wonderful thing about this. If that waiter comes and gives you one mint and then leaves and comes back with a handful of mints and says, I found some more mints for you guys. I hope you have a really nice day. Thank you so much for being here. Those tips go up 23%. And it's amazing. That mint costs, what, 10 cents maybe? But that tip and that reciprocal altruism effect is so ingrained in us, it's a social norm. All right, this is the third one, scarcity. This is actually my favorite. And the reason is, it takes a lot of guts as a brand to become a scarce brand, right? And usually only the most premium and the bravest brands are able to really use this to effect. And I'll give you an example of this one. The Apple iPhone has been one of the most revolutionary products in history, right? But they absolutely understood and leveraged the power of scarcity to build this brand. First of all, the Apple iPhone was only available 10 years ago when it came out at AT&T or at the Apple Store. It was something that investors said they were crazy. Why wouldn't you offer it to Sprint or Verizon? But it was only available at the one carrier or at the Apple Store. That's a brilliant move in scarcity. The other thing is, too, these lines. These lines that, you know, you see them, you read about them in the news, you think, oh my goodness, why are those crazy people standing in line? How many people have ever stood in a line for an iPhone? Me? I have. When the iPhone 4 came out, and I thought, who are these crazy people standing in the, oh, I guess I better get in line. I don't want to miss out the chance to get one. There's actually a lot of speculation that Apple was limiting the supply. I actually believe this is true. They wouldn't admit it, but in order to create lines, because the lines gave news, gave buzz, but it's a bold move. One of my favorite advertisements of all times is this one from Patagonia. This came out on Black Friday, day after Thanksgiving, 2011. And it's pretty bold. It was in the New York Times, and it says, don't buy this jacket. You think about that as some reverse psychology, but what it actually is they say, we ask you to buy less and to reflect before you spend a dime on this jacket or anything else. And you'll also notice they say, consider our R2 jacket shown here, one of our best sellers, and we'll talk about that as well. That's social proof. But they're using scarcity of natural resources to motivate you to feel a certain way about the brand. They're not actually trying to sell you anything, though I can almost guarantee that the sales went up for Patagonia when they told them not to buy this jacket. I was in a similar situation when I was, a year later, I was marketing a brand called Muir Glen Organic. It's a canned tomato brand. And our growers came back to us and they said, because of the rain, because of the season and the weather, we just don't have enough organic tomatoes for this year's production. And they said, well, would you like us to go with a little less quality tomato, a greener tomato, because we can probably stretch it out, we can make it work. And I said, no, let's instead issue a press release and tell people to please don't buy this year's tomatoes because we just don't have enough and we're not willing to compromise our quality in order to supply the broader group of people. And sales went up 15%. And we had other products, obviously, as well, that they could buy. But it worked. It works incredibly well. You have to be gutsy to use this one. All right, the next one is authority. And I'll spend a little bit of time on this one, but I actually want to start talking about authority by saying this is a tool that advertisers use often to convince you to do something because an expert probably knows better than you do. Right? And they don't explicitly say that. But think about the premier advertising event of the year. It's the Super Bowl. We saw Super Bowl ad earlier. Think about Super Bowl 2017, if you guys watched the ads. You know how many celebrities were involved in those ads? I'll just remind you guys. Justin Timberlake, Minnie Driver, Adam Driver, Tom Brady, Jason Statham, Melissa McCarthy, John Malkovich, remember that ad for Foursquare? George Takei, Lady Gaga. I actually worked on a brand that advertised last year's 2016 Super Bowl. We didn't use a celebrity. And then this year, they used a celebrity. It was Persil laundry detergent, and they used Bill Nye. Now, what does Bill Nye actually know about laundry detergent? I mean, maybe he knows a little bit. But what does Tom Brady know about microchips? Nothing. He's not an expert in microchips, but what he is he's influential. And when you use a celebrity, what happens is it gives people a window into a world of success. It gives them a window into the secrets of those that have attained something that they haven't attained. And if you have any celebrities, minor or major celebrities, that have ever visited your practice, it would behoove you to find out if there's a way, legally, to be able to use that as an element of authority for your practice. Okay? And we found that's worked incredibly well for the practices that we work with. All right, the other aspect of celebrity I'll mention to you is the way that authority is perceived. And I want to show you this one. It doesn't matter if you're recognized as a famous person, it can also matter if you portray yourself as someone that's an authority.
Let me talk to you about retirement.
401k is the most sound way to go. Let's talk asset allocation.
Sure.
You seem knowledgeable, professional.
Would you trust me as your financial advisor?
I would.
I would indeed.
Well, let's be clear here. I'm actually a DJ.
No way.
I have no financial experience at all.
That really is you.
If they're not a CFP pro, you just don't know. Find a certified financial planner professional who's thoroughly vetted at letsmakeaplan.org. CFP, work with the highest standard.
So obviously this DJ that they just recruited off of some nightclub looked like a certified financial planner, and he got a lot of trust. A lot of the research that's shown this. If you look the part, people will trust you. You don't have to be a celebrity in order to use this. Now, I can't be in a room full of dentists without paying homage to one of the most used advertising tropes, which is the 9 out of 10 dentists. And I just think this is, you know, kind of makes you wonder, doesn't it? What does that 10th dentist know that the rest of us don't? So, authority, right? And that's one of the reasons why, you know, you guys as dentists are so credible. Your certifications are credible, and how you present yourselves can create that authority. All right. Finally, the last is FOMO. It's the fear of missing out. And it's not just scarcity, right? Missing out on a product. It's missing out on an experience. People want to be a part of a club. They want to belong. When a Harley Davidson customer buys a Harley Davidson, they are automatically enrolled into the Harley owners group. Anybody a hog here? Yeah, right? You don't buy a Honda, you're not going to get into that club, right? So that is an aspect that you can use to create this sense of feeling elite or feeling involved or in the know. And this is actually, I would tell you, specifically for your younger patients, this is incredibly powerful. People are used to being connected to everything. They used to be connected to their friends. They're using Snapchat or instant messaging to be always in the know, always in the loop. You get your news automatically. It pops up on your phone. People, especially younger people, always want to be connected, and they want to be part of a group to share social experiences. One of the most powerful dental-oriented brands that I've seen do this is Crest. And I want to show you this. We're going to watch it twice because I think it's going to be interesting for you guys. You're going to take
Question. Listen. And be honest. Are my teeth yellow? Have you tried the tissue test?
The what?
Tissue test. Hold this up to your teeth.
Oh, yellow.
I don't get it. I use whitening toothpaste. What do you use?
Crest White Strips. You should try them.
Whitening toothpaste only works on the surface, but Crest White Strips safely work below the enamel surface to whiten 25 times better than a leading whitening toothpaste.
You use the white strips.
I passed the tissue test.
Oh, yeah.
Would you pass the tissue test? See for yourself with Crest White Strips. They're the way to whiten.
It's a lot of heads nodding, right? The tissue test. That's powerful stuff. I want you to watch this again. And the director for this ad made it. There's one little cut in this that is very, very powerful. And I want to just play it one more time here, and you'll pause it at the right spot.
Question, and be honest. Are my teeth yellow?
Have you tried the tissue test?
The what?
Tissue test. Hold this up to your teeth.
Oh, yellow.
Right there. That's social rejection. That is, I mean, it's just brief, but it's social rejection, and it's painful, right? You guys know as dentists, you know that pain and the fear of pain can motivate people to act. When you study the functional, you know, when you study the brain response of people when they've been rejected socially, it is just as powerful as physical pain for people. And that's what this ad is doing. Of course, there's a resolution and they get along, but this look, that is social rejection, and that's using the fear of missing out to a good effect. But we'd like to talk to you about finally, two more examples. This is one of the most famous copy lines that's been used in TV marketing, right? You have on the home shopping network, and they say at the end, operators are waiting, please call now. There was Louise Scott, one of the most famous and most effective copywriters and marketers for television, you know, instant response marketing. She made three words change that saw sales go up 50%. And that is using the fear of missing out to good effect. What she did was, she said, if operators are busy, please call again. Instead of having the image in your mind of all these operators sitting around these tables just waiting for you to call, this gives you the image that other people are calling, that you're going to miss out on this experience if you don't call right now. And even though you'll always get through, you'll never be busy, that response, that stimulus has been given to you, and you're likely to respond to it. Finally, I'll share with you one final example from my career. And this was before, when I was in business school, I did some work with a brand called Steinway & Sons. It's an exclusive brand of pianos. Our office was in Midtown Manhattan, and one of my responsibilities was to extend invitations to prominent community musical organizations. And we focused actually on houses of worship in Manhattan. And what we did was I said, you know, I'm working on an MBA, we gotta do this scientifically. What I'd like to do is measure the response when we try different things. And we tried this thing where we would hand deliver an invitation, but instead of, once we got a response, the next invitation that we sent out, we would actually customize it to say, so-and-so, you know, Fifth Avenue Presbyterian is coming, or, you know, the Unitarian Church on Columbus Circle is coming to this event. And we created this longer list, and the funny thing was, every time we did that, you know, the response went up, and it went up over 20% over what you would normally expect from a direct response. This idea of people wanting to be involved, and I had no idea that houses of worship were so, you know, socially, you know, afraid of being left out, but it was absolutely, for this market, it worked incredibly well. So those are just a few examples. What I'm going to do is I'm going to hand it over to Dave, and he's going to talk to you about some specifics for how these principles, these stimuli, can be used to good effect in persuading others.
Okay, so Brian's given you some of the underlying principles. We're now going to take that and go to some practical examples of how you can apply this to your dental marketing. I call this our six principles of persuasion. You could also refer to these as six tools to implement subconscious marketing principles into your marketing. The first principle, where it starts, is getting their attention. This is fairly simple. You just need something. You need a unique message. You need something that sets you apart in your practice. You don't want trite. This is a famous statement from Douglas Van Praet. Cognitive science tells us that we don't notice the world around us when it's reliably predicted away. In other words, you drive down the street, the same stuff is there, everything. You don't pay attention to that because your mind is too busy with new things. Something that you can predict is not going to register with you. When what we are experiencing in the moment matches our intuitive predictions, once we know the drill, the dig is up, we stop paying attention. So it's something that's different that's going to get our attention. So this is what you want to use as an initial approach. Pardon the quality, because this is an old classic commercial from many years ago that illustrates this principle.
I love the sound of the rain.
And I love the taste of your fresh fruit coffee.
Oh. Thanks, but it's not fresh fruit.
It's new Traeger.
Still going. Nothing outlasts the Energizer. They keep going and going and going.
Okay. So this commercial really uses that unexpected. Now, we have to be a little restrained in using this in dentistry because people are not too fond of outside-of-the-box dental care. But you need to use this to some extent, at least, and realize that if you look the same as everybody else, you're simply not going to get their attention. Here's some websites. These could be quality dentists, but beautiful smiles for a lifetime. You know, there's nothing there that gets my attention that makes me think that this practice is anything other than an ordinary dental practice. Stock photos, obvious. It seems like it looks like models that I've seen other places. This is another one, the kids on the back of the parents, yeah. Really overused, practicing family dentistry. This is not going to get their attention. So we always look for every practice that we market, we look for a unique tagline. For example, this Randy Burbage is on the board of directors here of the AACD. We tried to think, well, what's unique about his practice? Well, he practices with his dad. And it's been the same practice, and it's been going for two generations. And so his dad's did a residency in prosthodontics. Randy himself is accredited in cosmetic dentistry. They have patients that have been coming there for three generations. So this is the tagline that we chose for him to set him apart from everybody else in his community, dentistry that stands the test of time. And then down below, we've been delivering quality dental care for two generations. We know how to do dentistry that lasts. So one message, simply delivered, that sets you apart. This is, we're in the process of training a writer. I like to use, I've got a couple of these examples because our writer training is great for teaching you folks how to do this. She came up with this, Dr. Ralph Isola, who's in Sacramento, and came up with this tagline and said, no, this is too trite. Dentistry provided me carrying an upbeat atmosphere meeting. I said, we've got to leverage this. The thing that we noticed in the patient comments is that we had patients saying that he had a knack for getting the laugh. One patient said, I can't believe that I actually laughed through my root canal. And I said, this is his unique contribution to his community. We've got to figure out a way to get this across. And so we changed this to great dental experiences are served up here. And then that tagline below, a quote from him, I believe visiting the dentist shouldn't be scary, so if you're a little anxious, I'm going to find something we can laugh about together. So, find out what you have that you need, get their attention with that. Second, engage their emotions. We're going to spend a little more time on this. Emotions influence our thinking. More than thinking influences our emotions. Marketers are in the business of selling states of emotion, not products or services. Here we're starting to strike at the very heart of what you need to do. Chances are you've been relying too much on logic to sell yourselves to the public. But in essence, their decision to choose you as a dentist is based on whether they like you or not. And that's an emotional thing. Okay? So, learn how to sell the emotion. I'm going to give you a little experience. This is back 30 years ago. We had decided to build our dream home. And so we had to sell this existing home that we had. And I researched and found a very successful realtor. Problem was, in our existing home, it had old carpet downstairs. In the entry area, going into the dining room and up the stairs. And so I asked the realtor, what should we do about this? He said, oh, I got the solution. We will tell them in the listing, we'll even put a sign on the door saying that you will pay for new carpet. They can choose whatever carpet they want. Don't pay any attention to this carpet. You'll get your own. We listed it. We waited a week. Not much interest in the property. We waited several weeks. No offers, no buzz, nothing. I went back to him. I said, this is not working, Tim. Here's my idea. Let's take half of that $2,000 that we were going to lock for a carpeting allowance. Let's buy new carpet for the living room, which is what they see in the entryway, going up the stairs to the bedrooms, down the hall. Let's put the sign at the end of the hall saying, if you would like this carpet throughout the house, put it in your offer. We sold it in a week. So what was the difference? Why did one technique work and the other didn't work? If you believe marketing is about logic, the first technique should have worked, shouldn't it? It certainly makes sense. Why didn't that work? What's that? It might have been because he was a guy, you know, and is that a sexist comment? He didn't understand. That first impression when you open the door, that's when the subconscious decision occurs whether or not you're going to buy the house. You know that? The first impression subconsciously registers, yes, I like this house, I want it. We miss that. We lost the first impression, and we tried to make up for it in the end, and it didn't work. Okay? First, you have to first engage them, subconsciously, emotionally. Then you close the sale with logic. People want to be logical. if they like, if they open the door, they like the house, but something doesn't add up. You know, they go down to the basement and there are cracks, they're leaky, whatever, something that smells musty, you're not going to do it. You have to have a combination of a good first impression followed up by a logical conclusion. Okay, and you all know the power of the first impression. This is analyzing that power of the first impression. This is why the first impression matters so much, because it registers subconsciously, it stays with them. Okay, a lot of you invest a lot of money. This is the reception room of Dr. Deborah Gray Kane. You know her in Atlanta, she's one of our clients. We told her, you spend a lot of money here investing in your reception room. Why? What's to make a good first impression? Guess what? What happened?
You're good.
Guess what? That's not the first impression of your dental practice. The first impression is your website.
I want to jump in maybe and add one more thing. In brand marketing, when I work with products that are sold on shelves, we talk about several things. Procter & Gamble coined this term. It's called the zero moment of truth, and then the first moment of truth, and then there's the second moment of truth. The zero moment of truth is when the first thought pops into their mind, oh, I need to get some new laundry detergent. And what's the association that you have? The first moment of truth is when they actually come to the shelf and they see the packaging, and that makes a huge difference. Are they going to convert? At that point, though, the decision's kind of already been made. People are just looking for a reason not to do it rather than a reason to do it. And then the second moment of truth is when you take it home and you use it, you see how it works. But that isn't what makes the sale, usually. It's those combination, the consistency of that zero moment to the first moment to the second moment of truth.
We want you to apply the power of manipulating emotions to your social media also. Some people make the mistake of using social media to sell their practice. That's not its purpose. Its purpose is to build what general marketers would call brand loyalty or practice loyalty. What social media does for your practice is it raises the referral rate, because people become more enthusiastic about your practice. We have done studies too at Infinity Dental Web showing that patients that are engaged with you in social media will spend an average of 82% more per year in your practice than people that are not engaged, because you are developing that loyalty. So here's an example of an effective social media page. No selling here. Just helpful tips, the power of smiling, tips for a happy, healthy life. That's the kind of thing you want to do. Back off from this feeling you've got to be selling all the time. Many people don't even understand their own emotions. So we want to delve even a little deeper, you know, as we're getting in past the logic into the emotions. Please understand that you can't even ask people sometimes what they're feeling. They don't understand what they're feeling. Let's use an example here. And I'm going to use an example. This is Michael Andre, again, our chief marketing strategist. One of the thing that he did in his career that made him the most famous, he won an outstanding marketing award for it, was this research on this aspect of the people don't understand their own emotions. And here's a quote from his published paper on this back in 2010. Published this. Humans do not always say what they really think. Either they don't want to or are simply unable to do so. Basically, it is very difficult for humans to articulate or express what they really feel. The only logical explanation for the difference in results between implicit and explicit surveys is humans often don't know consciously what really motivates them. Okay, let's... He was a principal in a marketing agency in Dusseldorf, Germany. He's originally from Austria. And he was, they had a contract with Procter & Gamble to market Pantene hair care products, and they were going up against Dove. And we had this famous Dove marketing move where they had these models, a little pudgy, looked like ordinary women, and the idea was that people identified with these models more so than with the supermodels. So he wanted to develop a campaign. He was a little leery that this was correct. He wanted to test out whether people really identified with the Dove models or if they should go with supermodels. for their marketing, to market Pantene. And so let's have him discuss the results of his study.
Well, in the research, if you ask a person, who do you like better, what person is more attractive, attractive to you, what do you like better, which person, then in that research, it was like usually people would say 75% would go with the Dove woman in the advertising. 10% would be neutral, and maybe just 15% would say, you know, I like the Pantene woman better.
The supermodels.
Yeah, the supermodels. So that's when you ask a person consciously and the person answers, right? So when we put them in the scanner, and then you would look in the scanner, what happens? So when the scanner, you know, looks at the brain, what a person...
Yeah. He's talking about what they do in this subconscious research is they hook up scanners for their brain, and they can identify which centers in the brain are being activated, so they know what's really going on in there. So, and this is what he's saying they did. They showed these models. They showed the supermodels. They showed the Dove ordinary people models, and then they put them in the brain scanner and say, okay, let's find out what they're really thinking.
When we put them in the scanner, and then you would look in the scanner, what happens? So when the scanner, you know, looks at the brain, what a person, you ask the same question, you show them the pictures, you ask the same questions, then you suddenly see that actually that the supermodels have a far better memory, people, you know, better memory, they people like them better. So certain things that show up in the brain show actually that the people identify or like to identify more with the supermodels.
So when he published this research that he won this Atticus Award for marketing. But anyway, you can see these are the brain scan images on the left that are used to find out what people are really thinking. So stronger activation of memory, stronger activation of positive emotion centers. Okay, and so there we have the Pantene ambassadors. And Pantene sells more for hair care products than Dove. So I guess it works.
And I know because I worked for another competitor, not Dove or Pantene, but Schwarzkopf. And we were trying to sell shampoo into the United States that was a European brand. And we found that the only way we could really go after Pantene was to outdo them. And so we hired the European, more gorgeous supermodels to represent our brand and to actually put their face on the packaging. And we found that that actually worked to reinforce this concept of beauty and to trigger that response, their emotions in the mind of the consumer.
Okay, let's see. Yeah, surveys and polls don't measure unconscious reactions, and what consumers do, not what they say, is what matters. Okay? Before we get to the third principle, I want to take a little survey here. Okay, you're giving a treatment plan presentation. Say she needs 3 crowns, whatever. Do you think that the patient makes that decision whether or not to accept your treatment plan based on they understand the need, and the better you get at explaining it to them, the more success you'll have in treatment plan presentation? Or do you think it's just simply trust? Okay, what's a little survey? What do you think? Do you think that they understand the need? Those?
It's a combination. I don't think it's trust.
Yeah, okay. Well, we've primed you here. Trust, how many would say it's mostly on trust? Okay, see, we've already convinced you. Because when Suzanne Boswell asked this of dentists, of course, there were multiple reasons that they gave, but when you're comparing the need, they understand the need versus they trust the dentist, 40% said it was based on the need, 28% based on trust. When she asked patients the same question, you see it's an overwhelming trust. And when we asked Michael Andre, who has delved into the subconscious more than any of the rest of us. He said, if you understood what was actually going on in their minds, trust would be even higher. So, Suzanne Boswell asked patients how they choose a dentist. It's based on trust. They ask for a referral from somebody they trust. They ask for another professional. Trust is big in their minds. Why? This is something that's going on in the back of the mind of every one of your prospective patients, and maybe even of your own patients. And this is from Suzanne Boswell. Common focus group comment is, I want to go to someone who cares more about me than the money. I want this to sink down deep into your souls, because some of you are making some critical mistakes that are raising concerns deep in the minds, maybe not even consciously, of your patients and prospective patients. It could be in your treatment plan presentation, it could be in your initial marketing, it could be from the first impression that they get of your dental practice. Okay? She asked people what criteria they would use to choose a dentist today. I'm not going to go all the way through this, but these are the focus group comments she got. I see somebody taking pictures. Go ahead if you want to get this down. I'll give you a chance to do that. Okay? And then I've highlighted all the items that they mentioned that have to do with trusting the dentist, thinking he's a nice guy, these emotional kinds of things. It's overwhelming. So you've got to get away from the logic. You have to use the logic. That's maybe not said right. You've got to relegate logic to its proper role in converting. And you've got to get with the emotion, because that's where it's at. Okay? It's all about trust. That's the third principle of persuasion. Spend a little time on this. How do you get people to trust you? Just tell them, trust me. Right. How well does that work? That's going to trigger, you know, oh, trust me. You know what that's going to trigger. Yeah, right? Really? Subconscious marketing. There's a trust hormone called oxytocin. You may have heard about that. It's a hormone that's implicated in familial bonding behavior, where we have the highest level of trust within our own family. Okay? They did a study in Switzerland. Swiss and American scientists did a study. They had to find somebody posing as a financial advisor, trying to get them to buy an investment product. And they had sprays. One was a placebo. These are the nasal sprays. It's quickly absorbed. One was a placebo, the other was oxytocin. When they sprayed oxytocin into these people before they presented them the financial plan from this advisor, those that were sprayed with oxytocin invested twice as much money. So, we're not going to be advocating doing that. But you need to understand that this is emotional, this is a hormone, this is not going on at a logical level. People don't even know what's going on in their own minds. But you can know what's going on and you can use this. Okay? And I want to tell you my story, how I discovered this. As Brian mentioned, I had a lifelong fascination with marketing. And persuasion, anything like this. I was on the debate team in high school, and I just really loved the idea of, okay, how do I convince people to do whatever, you know, anything. And so when I opened my practice, I launched right out of dental school and started on my own, and it was nerve-wracking because I had all these debts, I had the equipment debt, I had my school loans, I did not have any patients. I sat by the phone, hoping people would call, they'd call. Okay, somebody would come in and say they needed the 3 crowns, like the treatment plan presentation I made. Okay, I think I was pretty good, you know, I just went in and I said, Mrs. Jones, you need 3 crowns. And most of them really accepted it. I think I was decent, but it bothered me the people that didn't. Later on in my practice, I got busy. And there were occasions when I had somebody and they needed the three crowns and the bridge and whatever, and I would actually think, oh my gosh, how am I going to fit this into my schedule? You know, Mrs. Jones, I would think in the back of my mind, I just get tired looking at your x-rays and thinking the amount of work you need. But I would give the same treatment plan presentation, in my mind, the same body language. And after a while, it dawned on me that I had a treatment plan acceptance rate of nearly 100%. So somehow people were reading, when I just came out of school, reading my neediness through signals I was unintentionally giving them. My tone of voice, my body language, something. When I had in the back of my mind, I don't really care personally if you do this or not, but you need to do this for yourself. When that was in my mind, the trust went up, way up. The people that were skeptical were not skeptical anymore. Okay? Trust is important in medicine, right? But when you think about it, it's even more important than dentistry. When you go to a doctor, you usually have symptoms. You know something's wrong. When you've looked at the x-rays and you've done the exam and you say, listen, you have a leaky, this crown is leaking, you know, you have these cavities, I'm seeing some interproximal decay, and you know what else? You've got bone loss. They don't know that anything's wrong. They're going entirely on your word. So trust is so critical. And then they've heard these stories of people, you know, they had a friend, cavities that weren't there. They read a Google review. Now, I've seen some of them. Well, I went to this dentist, you know, and then I went to the dental school. And they said I had five cavities, and the dental school said, well, you don't have a cavity. You know, or they needed, you know, people that scammed them with a full mouth reconstruction. Back to this. This is the worry that's in the back of their minds. Do you really care? Are you going to be honest with them? Can they trust you? And that's what they're, and when you make a recommendation, a treatment plan recommendation, it's going to be based on this trust. And this trust is going to start, if your website leads them to believe that you're not trustworthy, that's going to stick with them. Let's go through a general marketing example. General Motors bankruptcy was a critical trust issue for this General Motors Corporation. And to deal with this bankruptcy, to deal with the marketing challenge of reestablishing trust, guess who they went to? Our old friend Douglas Fenbright. So he analyzed the problem. He did a little research. He found that people felt betrayed. This was the great American brand, General Motors, and they were failing. It was almost like the country was failing. They were mad. They felt, you know, why'd you screw up, General Motors? So his premise was that they could not go and, in a marketing way, puff out their chests and try to say, listen, we're good. We know what we're doing, you know. That would not work. He would have to go the humility direction. Admit their faults, and then try to move past that in a positive way. So let's watch the commercial that he came up with that was highly successful in helping turn General Motors around. And see if you can discover the principles that will help you.
To be completely honest, no company wants to go through this. But we're not witnessing the end of the American car. We're witnessing the rebirth of the American car. General Motors needs to start over in order to get stronger. There was a time when eight different brands made sense. Not anymore. There was a time when our cost structure could compete worldwide. Not anymore. Reinvention is the only way we can fix this. And fix it, we will. So here's what the new GM is going to be. Fewer, stronger brands. Fewer, stronger models. Greater efficiencies, better fuel economy, and new technologies. Leaner, greener, faster, smarter. This is not about going out of business. This is about getting down to business. Because the only chapter we're focused on is chapter one.
Okay,
So that's their pitch for trust. Let's see if we can apply the same principles. Okay, we talked about the trust hormone, oxytocin. This is the antitrust hormone. This is the stress hormone, cortisol. This is what's going on biochemically in the brain. And when you give incongruent signals, it's shown that it will raise the level of cortisol in the person that's either reading or seeing or experiencing this. So watch for this in your marketing. When things don't add up, something just doesn't feel right, there's a mismatch of signals being sent, neurochemicals of stress like cortisol are released, warning us to hold back and be wary. Again, I keep hammering this point home. A lot of times people are not even aware that this is going on in their minds, but this is what's happening. Inauthentic advertising and salesmanship are like telling someone how much you care while simultaneously averting your gaze and fidgeting nervously. You know, we talked before, when we talked about this oxytocin spray, you know, it kind of gives the impression like you can manipulate people with this and it's really not ethical. But in actuality, the way our brains are programmed to pick up these signals are actually much more accurate than relying on logic alone. So, the way my patients picked up on that, I really, really wanted them to get this dental work done so I could pay my student loans, you know. It's very effective, you know. We're good at this. So we want to avoid things that stimulate this cortisol. And then we have what's called, I want to introduce you to what's called the BS alarm here. I was presenting this to my wife, and my wife says, "Dave, you're a Mormon, you can't say that." And I said, I looked. There is no other real word that really says this as effectively as the BS alarm. So, anyway, it's a bologna sandwich alarm, okay, whatever. Incongruities generate these chemicals. Okay, I want to hit this. Your eagerness to get them to make an appointment is a key signal that will trigger the BS alarm. I see this so much. And then besides triggering the BS alarm, we go back to Brian's, the principles, the scarcity, the social proof. It creates the impression that you really need the patients, you know. And then the question that arises in your mind, if you're so good, why do you need these patients so badly? You know, why is your schedule book empty? So there's this great study done by one of our competitors. I've got to give them a shout out for this because they did a great job on this, and I used this in training our writers. 2009 study. They got people making dental appointments. They found a group of people in various parts of the country. A research firm tracked them down for them, and they were looking for a cosmetic dentist. And they agreed to be part of the study where they would actually have their computer monitored remotely, and then they would speak out loud what was going through their minds as they were searching for a cosmetic dentist. And one of them was confronted with a pop-up like this, and I thought the comment that they heard from the patient as they saw this pop-up was very revealing. Patient said, "Pop-ups are kind of like, hey, don't leave, give me your money." Okay, what's in the back of her mind? Of Tara from North Carolina. It's this same question I told you about before that Suzanne Boswell said, do they care more about me or they just want my money? Okay, and the pop-up is sending a signal to Tara that kind of looks like you want my money. Okay, this is a prospective client that just called us last week. Very high quality dentist in suburban Chicago. I looked at his website and I said, "Ken, okay, I'm looking at your website.
and I'm listening to you tell me about how you deliver quality dentistry, how you don't care whether the patient gets it from you necessarily or from the person down the street, but you deliver quality beyond what anybody else in your community is delivering. You want them to understand that, you want them to trust you, and then here on your homepage it says, contact us today. Why today? He said, I don't know. Why is it important? He's saying it's important to Dr. Coffee that they contact him today. Why? Because he doesn't want them to go away. That is sending a signal to them. It's reflecting an eagerness to get an appointment. Get rid of the today. You don't want to be distant. You don't want to act like you don't care whether they make an appointment, but you don't want to go to the point of being perceived as eager about it. You want to be welcoming but not needy. Okay, and this goes back to the study that we did. And this is, I told you we were going to tell you why. The calls decreased by 30% when we put up a simple request for an email address. This is what's going on in the minds of the patient. We sent a trigger to them. Okay? Bragging triggers the BS alarm. You want to present your credentials, of course. You're accredited. You want people to know that. You know, you attended Panky, whatever. You want people to know that. But there are ways to do that without sounding like you're puffing out your chest. Here's an example. I found this website because I was doing a search for copyright violations, and this guy had posted my before and after pictures in his smile gallery. And then his little about me thing, Dr. Reiner, I blotted out his name, is a graduate of the prestigious USC Dental School. Get rid of the prestigious, for Pete's sake. It's a dental school. You don't need that. Okay? And here's Steve Murphy. Are you here? Oh. Are you Denise? Okay, you're going to see how little our sausage is made. So we had a new writer that we had hired, excellent writer. She actually teaches writing at a community college, or did in the past teach writing at a community college, excellent writer. But we have to go through this with all the writers. I like to use these examples because, and Steve, you know, she was quite taken with his qualifications and won several medals in the International Smile Gallery competition here at the AECD back when we used to have that. And so she's writing about porcelain crowns, and she wanted to put a case up there. And I'm going to enlarge the text here that I told her, no, this is not going to work. Let's teach you about these marketing principles. Basically saying that Dr. Murphy is wonderful, he won the Smile Gallery, the other dentists, you know, down the street are not going to do as nice a job on your porcelain crown as he is. You're bragging, you're triggering the BS alarm. I said, gotta get rid of all that, revamp this, and take all this out. She's a quick learner. And she came up with this, just a basic explanation. And we're showing off his knowledge and his abilities by presenting accurate facts about the various types of crowns, zirconia crowns, Emex crowns, all porcelain crowns. Whatever. And then we're using this, the photograph down below of his of one of his winning cases for the International Smile Gallery. But in the text we say nothing about it. But we've kind of left the gold medal little tag on his photo because that was part of the photo. So we felt like this was a little a non-braggadocious way of letting people know, letting them discover on their own that, hey, this is a high quality dentist. Without bragging about it, okay? Okay, the fourth principle of persuasion is get them to dream. How many of you ever used direct mail marketing? Okay, what's a typical response rate?
It was really great before, and all of a sudden, it did not come back.
Single digits?
question.
That's right.
Yeah, just what time the hours?
10,000 mailers, 30 responses, okay. Yeah, typical rates. There's just some typical rates in general marketing. They come from general marketing. Depending on the type of thing, you know, whether you're fundraising or as opposed to direct sale is the least response rate. And if it's personalized or not, if it's not personalized, it's going to be around 1 or 2%. Okay, there's a company in a car dealership in Toronto. They wanted to do a direct mail campaign to get people to come to its dealership, schedule a test drive. Porsche dealer, Pfaff Porsche in Toronto. They had an interesting way of going about this that we can apply to dentistry, especially cosmetic dentistry. They took this brand new white Porsche, parked it in front of different houses in an upscale neighborhood in the Toronto area, and then took a picture of the car parked there almost in the driveway of that house. Went from house to house taking these pictures. Then they created a mailer personalized with a picture of the Porsche in the driveway of that person. And then asked them to call for a test drive. Response rate, 32%. Okay? Get people to imagine themselves with this new smile. Figure out a way to do that. We use this in some of our taglines. You know, this is Dr. Deborah Gray King's site. Imagine yourself with one of these beautiful smiles, another accredited member in San Diego. You can become the person, that's the main tagline, you can become the person with the winning smile. Talk to them and do this. And then I think an underutilized tool that we have is the digital smile makeover. I would like to encourage you maybe to think about that and think if there's a way that you can do that. I used this, I bought one of these back in the early days. It was way expensive. You know, I mean, the software was thousands of dollars. And this is one of the images, and it was very rudimentary. And you had to basically pretty much hand draw the teeth on there. They have automated systems now that make it so easy. You know, your assistant can do it. But when someone would go through this and say they're kind of interested in a smile makeover, we do this, what we call the video imaging or digital smile makeover. If they could afford it, they bought it. And I've checked with some of our clients that use this, and that's what they get. We have a client in Michigan that they do a digital smile makeover on every patient. And of those that have any kind of an interest in smile makeovers at all, they say about 50% of them go ahead and they do it. So, and then these are newer ones. Send them home with a picture. Let them show their family, significant others. You know, people worried that, oh, they're going to expect the unachievable if I can't actually produce what that picture shows. I'm sorry, I did this for many years. I never had a problem with that. So, and you know, but if you're worried about it, just put a little disclaimer on there. So, okay, and then use the power of association. How many have tried Colgate kitchen entrees? Do you know, are they good? Do you like them? Anybody try these? Okay. This is a classic, colossal marketing failure from the failure to understand the power of association. Colgate is a toothpaste. It's minty fresh. You rinse it out of your mouth and spit it into the drain. It's not particularly appetizing. Launched in 1982, failed in 1982. People did not, you know. Anyway, it's a classic marketing. They discuss this in marketing school.
Okay. Cheskin was using the power of association back as of the early pioneers, as early as 1940, telling them the reason the margarine's not selling is because it's white. It looks like lard. Color it yellow, it tastes the same, it acts the same. You couldn't tell the difference if you had blinders on. But the yellow you associate with butter. Okay? He did this experiment. He got homemakers doing laundry and got them three samples of laundry detergent. One was in a blue box, one was in a yellow box, and one was in a blue box with yellow spots on it. And then asked them to evaluate these detergents. The blue box came back. Many of the consumers said they had insufficient dirt-busting power. Some complained that it left their clothes dirty-looking. The yellow box, too strong. Some of them complained that it ruined their clothes. The blue box with yellow spots, oh, this is just right. The overwhelming favorite. The women use such words as fine and wonderful in describing the effect the detergent in that box had on their clothes. The kicker, you probably guessed it, is the exact same laundry detergent. The only thing different was the packaging. So, how are you packaging your dental practice to use the power of association? Okay, if you're selling beautiful dentistry, we asked Michelandre to expound on this for you. What are the associations? How are you going to convince somebody that you do beautiful dentistry using the power of association? Okay, let's listen.
So, Michelandre, how could I convey to a prospective patient through my website that I do beautiful cosmetic dentistry?
I think that's very important, obviously, because if we just had the question before about healthy and beautiful. If I talk about healthy, there's certain signals people have learned in their lives. If we talk about beauty, people have learned certain signals, certain things that fit to beauty. So if you want to talk about beauty, or you want to present beauty, you have to use the signals of beauty. Represent that in your internet site.
If you talk about what would that be?
Beauty. Obviously, nice people smiling, showing nice teeth. Often, beauty has to do with expensive. So I would say probably also looking more expensive, more roomy, more room, more space, white space.
You mean on the website?
On anything, really. I mean, you look at the Apple products, for example. You always see them alone, wide space, a lot of room. Anything that's expensive has a lot more space. It's not crowded. If it's cheap, right, everything is crowded. You can go into a place where everything lays around and you can take it and prices, and it's crowded. Expensive has a total different look. It's always open, less space, and more space.
Okay, and we should convey that, then they should convey that.
Yeah, you have to convey that, yeah. Because that's what people have learned in their lives, right? A person who has money has a bigger house, right? And he has a bigger house, he has more space between his neighbor. So space is a sign of expensive, having more, right?
Okay.
And that belongs mostly to beauty.
Okay. The association then is beautiful, expensive. You're not going to get around that. You're not going to change people's feelings. They've learned this their whole lives. And the association is space. You have a crowded website. I'm sorry. You're going to have a problem selling beautiful cosmetic dentistry. You need to look like you have space to spare. And that conveys the signal of beauty, of high quality. So, look at the companies that market quality, and he used the example of Apple. They really use this. You know, their ads are simple, lots of white space. It doesn't necessarily have to be white. It can be dark colors, but it can't be crowded.
It can look like you're trying to jam a lot of facts in. Okay? Interesting on this associations. There's researchers at Stanford and Caltech did this wine tasting study about 9 years ago. They had a wine that cost $90 a bottle. They poured it into two different glasses and gave it to the subjects of this study. What they did, though, was one of the glasses, they told them it was a $10 wine. It was actually a $90 wine. They told them it was $10. And the other wine, they said, yeah, this is a $90 wine. Which one do you like better, the $90 or the $10? Well, you know, you're going to like the $90 wine better. The interesting thing is they did brain scans on these people. And the $90 wine actually did taste better. It activated, it had stronger activation of the pleasure centers of the brain. Just the idea. That's the power of association. And we learned this with the Coke-Pepsi study. You give people the unmarked glasses. Some people will prefer the Coke, yes, but most people will prefer the Pepsi. You give them in the marked bottle, the association with the Coke and its advertising and this open happiness thing and all the branding, the money that they've invested in that branding, actually enhances the taste of the product.
Let me just say something. I used to market food. And I felt a little sleazy sometimes because we would tell people, give them associations and tell them what to expect. The photography, and this is a dirty secret for food marketers, the photography, you know, for restaurants or for, you know, food, when they show you the pictures, it's pretty doctored up. And I remember specifically just being in this photo shoot and this, you know, we were showing this, you know, beautiful, you know, everything was perfectly placed and it had this little glisten, a glow. We actually used wax for the tomato, you know, drops and the, you know, the water. And I kept thinking to myself, man, this is really sleazy stuff that we're doing here. We're really giving this impression that it's, you know, different than what it really is when you open up the product. And this concept, though, somebody, you know, mentioned to me, they said, well, it's actually going to make the food taste better. And I said, well, no, we're going to fool people that the food's going to taste better. And they said, no, it'll actually make the food taste better. The presentation and the awareness, the price, all these things are signals and does actually change the experience that you have. And it's a very authentic thing to do as a marketer. You want people, as a dentist, you want people to have a good experience. You want them to be happy with the work. And as you do these things, they will be happier with the work. They'll be more satisfied and you know, feel that they have fuller, richer lives.
And then, of course, they then as part of the study, they, without telling them any prices, they asked them which the five wines tasted the best. The $5 wine won. Can you believe that? So, but, yeah. And then logic. I told you, you know, we're not going to get really totally away from logic. We want to get you deprogrammed to thinking it's all about logic. Logic is what closes the deal. As I showed you before in the little diagrams of the brain, you start the sale subconsciously, emotionally, you create a first impression, all this is going on subconsciously, you get them convinced. Then people, depending on their personality, to varying degrees, are going to want to justify that emotional subconscious decision that they have made, and they will use logic to do so. If the logic doesn't add up, you will lose the patient. They will not call. But if the logic is consistent and it builds on the emotion that you created, then they will call. When our emotional desires begin to shift toward a prospective brand, we subsequently seek to align our reasons to be consistent with that intention. Our rational mind is always looking for evidence to support our dominant beliefs. This is how the human mind works. And we're going to get into three principles of the logical aspects of persuasion. Three principles that you need to employ as you're presenting yourself in any marketing material, including your website. The first is to keep it simple. Okay, we're going to go again to Van Praat. The characteristic of the logical aspect of your mind is it has a limited attention span. It's focused. While the unconscious mind is immensely more powerful, it responds but doesn't think. On the contrary, our conscious mind is thoughtful and skeptical, but has a limited attention span. So you don't want to throw a lot of stuff out there. If you look at successful advertising, it generally takes 30 to 60 seconds to make one simple point. Okay? One point at a time. Classic branding error here for this homeowner. He's got to decide whether he wants to advertise that he has a show dog or whether he has a watchdog. And he has not made up his mind, and something we know that doesn't add up here. This is I blotted out his name, his picture and everything, because I'm sorry, we looked at this and we chuckled a little bit at the office. Look at this logo up in the upper right. The Center for Advanced Dentistry. Okay, what is his primary branding? Is this a fun place to go, or is this a highly expert dentist? He's trying to make both points at the same time. It's not going to work. Okay, exceptional dentistry and a fun and relaxed atmosphere. You know what, that may be true, but make one point up front, and then later on decide which is the secondary point, and then make that later. So, this is a very successful website. It's been a very plain website, very different branding than you're going to do if you're selling cosmetic dentistry. But this is highly successful, and it makes one point. We cater to cowards. We're gentle, and people get the message. And he gets about 50 new patients a month from this website. Okay, this is what you don't want to do. Might be an excellent office, trying to cram too much. And you scroll down the page and there's even more. There's testimonials, there's free dental implants, there's trusted doctors, there's all kinds of stuff. This is from one website that we're about ready to launch. You know, there are a lot of pictures on here. We're not trying to say you don't want material, but it's all centered around this concept of we're going to provide a relaxed atmosphere that focuses on you. We're going to get you relaxed. You're going to come into our office. One point in this section of the website. Okay? Second point, give them a reason to believe. So, the song. I didn't realize when I looked this up, the images on this, how many people have sung this song, Give Me a Reason to Believe. So, you make this statement, Dr. Jones is a caring dentist. Oh, come on. Isn't everybody, or at least they claim they're caring? There's some people that are not caring, but they will still claim to be caring. I've known some of those people. So. But what some writers and marketers want to do then to just give it a little more oomph is just throw in some extra adjectives. So, really caring dentist, let's go even a step further. Absolutely a wonderfully caring dentist, yeah. Okay, the missing ingredient is the reason to believe. Okay, you can portray yourself as a caring dentist, but you have to have something to back it up. The problem we find in marketing some of our clients, we want to make some point, and I'll, you know, as I'm training the writer, I'll say, okay, you've made this point, you don't have anything to back it up. I suspect you just guessed that they were this way. Find what they're really like, explain that, document it, and drive the point home. So here's what some will do. This is only a slight step above just saying he's a caring dentist. That's quoting a patient claiming you're a caring dentist. But you do this, you illustrate it, you've now given them the reason to believe. You provided a story. Came in on a weekend to help with my dental emergency. You don't even have to say he's a caring dentist, and you've conveyed that message. You throw in that he goes on humanitarian missions to Haiti every year, and you've really driven the point home. Other claims don't have the same threshold as claiming that you're caring. For example, the office runs on time. Okay, we do want to illustrate that. So it would be nice to have a testimonial from a patient that validates that. But this is a measurable. You can go in and measure it. It's a little harder to get away with making that claim if you don't have it. So different kinds of statements, the point here is, have different thresholds of claiming. If your claim is expertise, testimonials are effective, but they're not as effective as professional endorsements, professional credentials, accreditation, AECD accreditation, fellowship in the ICOI, whatever, mastership in the AGD, extra letters after your name, whatever they are. So we'll convey that expertise to patients more than testimonials. Okay, and here's a dentist. I picked out this as an example. Could be an excellent dentist, but you'll see the things that I've circled. We're going to provide you with excellent care. We're committed to excellence in patient care. You know, I'm sorry, it's just not going to be nearly as strong as documenting that in some way. Get beyond just making the claim. And if you can't find any documentation, you know what? Maybe it's not even a valid claim. Hate to say that. But we do this with our clients. We dig. We find, okay, what are the valid claims that we can validly make, that we can stand behind, that we can honestly portray to the prospective patient? Every dentist we've taken on has had something. Find out what it is. Claim. And then show, don't tell. So, these little drawings speak for themselves. I used to, back in my background, I had a time when I ran a book publishing company. This is a fundamental principle of good writing, good fiction writing. you tell a story. For example, rather than saying that we had one writer that we coached and she had this scene where the protagonist was, you know, really anxious and worried about the sound that he heard in the bushes. And she just said that he was really, anxious. And I said, no, go back, rewrite that part of the scene and say he fumbled for his keys and he couldn't get his key to fit in the lock. People will read that into it. There's two reasons that showing is better than telling. One of them is that it provides, again, it's the reason to believe. It illustrates the principle so that they can see it and they believe it then. The other reason is that you're engaging people. You're letting them close the logical loop themselves. That's a more powerful, convincing technique than actually telling them. So if we say Dr. Jones is a caring dentist, we basically told them the conclusion that they're supposed to draw. If we say, well, if we quote Misty as saying, well, they came in on a weekend, they're closing the loop and they're making the conclusion themselves. And having made it themselves, they're more convinced. So here's an example from Dr. Deborah Gray King's website. We took this section of the website, and initially she had a description of this, claim saying that we're concierge type, we have a dental concierge, and we have this pampering environment and whatever, and how are we going to tell people this? And it was filled with a lot of adjectives that, you know, you're going to come in, you're going to have a wonderful experience, it's going to be like no other experience you've ever had. We rewrote it to just tell the story. And so this is what we did. When you arrive for your new patient appointment, our dental concierge will come out and greet you in the reception area. We'll offer you refreshments and give you a tour of the office. When it comes time for treatment, you'll discover more of our amenities, ceiling television, the operatories, noise-canceling headphones. We're describing the experience. our roving massage therapist on staff, oral sedation if you want, personal attention throughout. Your treatment consultant will be your personal guide through the entire process, answering any questions you may have. Draw your conclusions from the story we took. These are the things we took out. They said, our exceptional customer service. No, let them, they can draw that conclusion. Just tell them what happens. Unlike most dental offices, again, they let them figure that out themselves. Engage their minds. Trust them to make an accurate conclusion, providing one-on-one attention. We take great pride in our knowledge and experience. You don't need that. So, interestingly, the calls, when we revamped their website, the calls went up like 60% from the rebranding that was done. This is another client in suburban Chicago. Each year, Dr. Potts and the team host Smiles from the Heart, a free day of dentistry for those 18 years and older who need dental treatment, blah, blah, blah. Okay? We don't have to say this is, he's got a great sense of civic responsibility. We don't have to say he's a caring dentist. We just have to tell the story. Okay? So, let's wrap it up with Michael Andre explaining how the mind works when they're deciding to choose you as a dentist.
So, so this decision process, then, it starts off in the amygdala. There's an emotional component. Then it goes to the
frontal cortex. Yeah.
So it's more logical.
More logical. It's more
okay. Distracted. But now they're looking at the website. Like, for example.
Pause that for a second. Yeah. Okay, let me say, because it's a little, the audio is not as good a quality. The amygdala is the center of the emotions. That's subconscious. That's the part of the brain. It's kind of near the brainstem. And that's what we're talking about. So the decision process starts there in the subconscious area and then moves into the frontal cortex, which is the logical area of the brain. So.
Yeah, more logical. It's more
okay,
distracted.
But now they're looking at the website. Like, for example, we know that when someone's choosing a cosmetic dentist, the first page they'll go to is the smile gallery.
Right.
So tell us what's going on then with the person as far as this process and the logical and the interplay of the logic and emotion.
I would always say a person has a goal, even if it's subconsciously. Everything we do is through a goal. I'm hungry, so my goal is to eat, right, and to get some food. So everything is depending on the goal. So if I go on an internet site and look for a dentist that gives me the beautiful look, I will look exactly for all the signals, and that's subconsciously, that tell me that I will get my beautiful teeth. So I'm looking for those signals. So you have to present those signals to that person that they can see that as a goal fulfillment. Image. That happens all subconscious. So seeing signals, interpreting it, and saying that person or that dentist or that internet site fulfills my future goal or my goal I have. Yeah.
Okay.